because we've got kingdom business to take care of. And the same is true today. We have kingdom business to take care of. We need to get ourselves up, quit wallowing, and say, Lord, I am your servant. Like Isaiah said, when God says, who shall I send? And Isaiah said, send me.
Good morning. We want to welcome you to our Sunday morning broadcast. Pastors David and Donna Spearman welcome you. Welcome to Kingdom First, located here in Fort Wayne. As we say, God loves Fort Wayne. Please feel free to share today's broadcast with as many people as you know. Also, feel free to comment if you get encouraged, blessed, or stirred up as you hear the Word of God. And use the emojis at any time to get our online activity to be heard throughout our time. If you're watching YouTube Live, display us on your smart TV for your entire family to watch. But now, let's get into this power-packed message.
Can we give God a shout of praise this morning?
Hallelujah!
Because God is an awesome God.
Awesome.
Praise you, Jesus.
Yes.
Oh, bless your name, Lord God.
Glory to God.
We glorify you, Lord. Lord, you are awesome. Sing, Lord.
Lord, you are awesome.
You are awesome. Sing, Lord.
Lord, you are awesome.
Bless the Lord. Hallelujah.
Lord, you are awesome.
Glory be to God. Sing, Lord.
You are awesome.
God is awesome.
You are awesome.
amazing.
You are awesome.
And you're worthy, Lord.
You are awesome.
We give you glory.
You are awesome.
We give you honor.
You are awesome.
You are my delight.
You are awesome.
Bless you, Lord. Take it up.
You are awesome.
You are our healer.
You are awesome.
You are my deliverer.
You are awesome.
Thank you, Lord God.
You are awesome.
You are awesome.
You are awesome.
Cause the lame to walk.
You are awesome.
Cause the blind to see.
You are awesome.
Cause the deaf to hear.
You are awesome.
Hallelujah. Lord, we give you praise. Another shout of victory to the Lord. Hallelujah. For he's glorious. For he's marvelous. Bless you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise awesome God.
He's worthy, saints, of all the glory, honor, and praise. We can't praise him and thank him enough. Hallelujah. I thank you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, for all that you have done for us, how you have been considerate of man, mindful of us, Lord God. You're the one that has given us a way of escape. And I thank you, Lord God. If it were not for you, we would all be doomed to hell. But I thank you, Lord God, in Jesus' name, for your salvation. Thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Bless your name, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Light of the world.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see.
To see my sin,
sin
upon
that cross.
How dare
you know
how much
it cost
to see my sin
upon that cross.
Lord, I worship you. I bless you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Here I am to worship you. Here I am to bow down, Lord. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely.
Lord, you're lovely.
Rain forever.
Talking or preaching about Jehovah Megan, the Lord our protector, our shield, and we began to go into Ephesians chapter 6 and talking about the full armor of God, where he says, finally be strong in the Lord and the strength of his might, put on the full armor of God. And we began to talk about that armor, and we've got down to where we were. The Bible tells us about what that armor is: having stand firm, having your having girded your loins with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, in addition to all taking up the shield of faith with which you'll be able the shield of faith with which you'll be able to extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. With all, and so most of the time, I think I told you last week. Most of the time, people think, okay, that's it. That's the full armor of God. But last week, I began to share with you the fact that that's not it, because the next verse tells us, with all prayer and petition, pray at all times in the Spirit. And with this in view, be on the alert with all perseverance and petition for all saints, and pray on my behalf, he says, that utterance may be given to me in the opening of my mouth to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I'm an ambassador in chains, that in proclaiming it, I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. And so we entitled that particular portion, or this particular portion concerning prayer, Waging War with Prayer. waging war. And so you have to understand and know that you are now, and as far as the world is concerned, you are now in the resistance. We are the resistance of the army of the living God. Listen, welcome to the resistance, because it's only by resisting the devil that he'll flee from you. If you don't want to be plagued, if you don't want to go through what the devil has for you to go through, then you have to resist him. And even if you go through some stuff, you still resist the devil and know that God is bringing you through. Amen? All right, so last week we talked about a few things and just a few highlights. We said that the two things that are that you can frighten the devil with or Satan with is the Word of God and prayer. Those two things terrify him, the Word of God. When you speak the Word of God, and we have a biblical assurance of that based on when Jesus was in the wilderness. And being in the wilderness, he was tempted, the Bible says, three times. And after the 40 days of fasting, the devil came to tempt him. And each time, he did not rebuke the devil with, hey, get away from me or leave me alone. He spoke the Word of God. He spoke out of the Word of God. So the Word of God is what you can use to resist the devil. That's why it is imperative that you as a Christian know what the Word of God has to say. If you don't know what the Word of God says, if you don't have the Word of God in your heart, then you're going to fall prey to his schemes and his plans each and every time. The Bible says one of the things about the armor of God is we have a shield of faith, and that shield of faith does what? It quenches the fiery darts of the wicked. So your shield of faith is a weapon, a defensive weapon, that shields you, your faith in Christ. But the way you offensively go against him is with the Word of God. You don't want to have to always keep the shield up. There are times you need to go against him to get him to get off your back, to get away from your vicinity. Amen? And so we talked about that there, the things that frighten Satan are the Word of God and prayer. We also talked about that Satan does not fear you as an individual. He can care less about you. He's not afraid of you. He's not afraid of your intellect, your good looks, or even how well you sing in a choir. He could care less. None of that stops him from attacking you. All right? He fears the fact that you in prayer are at the throne of God. He fears the fact. You don't have to look like a warrior. You are a warrior. You don't have to look the part. You know, we have these visions of what we think a warrior looks like, some, you know, really beefed up guy with, you know, shield and sword. You are a warrior because you are in the army of the living God. You are a warrior because God has raised you up, because God has called you out of darkness into light. You immediately, at that point, was enlisted in the army of God. I know in the church today, we don't talk about the army of God. We don't talk about being warriors. We don't talk about any of that kind of stuff. But I'm here to tell you this morning that if you are going to be successful in this life, then you have to see yourself as several things. First off, you have to see yourself as being in the kingdom of God, a citizen of the kingdom. You're not of this world, you're in it, but you're not of this world. Your makeup is not of this world. Your thought pattern is not of this world. The things you do in life are not of this world. You are in it only because God has taken you out of the world. Amen. He's taken you out of the world, made you a new creature in Christ. Any man being Christ is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Listen, you are a new creature. So you are now a citizen of the kingdom of God. And because you're a citizen of the kingdom of God, and every citizen is like in Israel today, every citizen is compulsory to be in the military. You have to be in the military. In the kingdom of God, you are in the military. You are in God's military. You are a soldier of the cross. And so as you go forth in your day-to-day activities, yeah, you go to work to feed your family, you do all those things, but your primary mission in life, your primary goal is to do exactly what Jesus said in Matthew 28. Go into all the world, preach the gospel, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. That is our primary mission. Never forget what your mission is. Soldier, never forget who you are and who you belong to, what side you're on. The enemy will do any and everything he can to pull you back to his side. He'll do any and everything he can to cause you to think that God has left you, that you're lost out there and all alone. But you're not all alone. Why? Because the minute you got saved, you were filled with the Holy Spirit of God. That means you are filled with God himself, because the Holy Spirit is God. Somebody say that with me. The Holy Spirit is God. Just as Jesus is God, the Father is God, the Holy Spirit is God. And the Bible says that you were filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, listen, there's a difference. Not that the Spirit came upon you like in the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, the Spirit came upon them. He didn't fill them. He just came upon them. A little different. But for you and me and every other saint of God today, because of Jesus Christ, he said, what did he tell us? He said, listen, I'm going away, but I will not leave you comfortless. He says, I'm going to send the Comforter that he may dwell in you. There's a difference comparing somebody being upon you and something dwelling in you. And so the Spirit of the Lord, the Holy Spirit, dwells in you. And because he dwells in you, not temporarily, but permanently. David said, take not your Holy Spirit away from me. Why did he say that? Because the Spirit was just upon him. He could lose that connection, but he dwells in you permanently. So you are not alone. That's the whole point. You are not by yourself. You may be by yourself physically out here in the midst of a terrible world, but you are not by yourself, because you have God who dwells within you. Come on, somebody. And so because of that, you are a different type of being. There's only two type of people in this world, and it ain't black and white. It is saved and unsaved. It is those who are under the law of sin and death, and it's those who are in the kingdom of God, who have been bought with a great price by the blood of Almighty Jesus. So there's only two types of folks, people. So you've got to realize who you belong to, where you are, what country you belong to. Now, I'm not talking about the United States. I'm talking about the kingdom of God. So what country you belong to, who you are. And once you understand who you are, then you're not afraid. Then you don't walk in fear, because you realize the devil, no matter how much he goes about as a roaring lion seeking to devour you, he can't devour you, because he can't devour somebody who's armored up. Because that armor makes you invincible. That armor allows you to walk through this world and be able to dispel every demon and every devil that gets in your way. Come on, somebody. We talked last week about the fact that he doesn't fear you, but he fears the word that's in your heart. He fears the Holy Spirit that dwells in you. He fears when you pray. So therefore, we ought to make sure that we are obeying the Holy Spirit in our heart. We got to make sure that we're speaking the word of God at all times. Come on, somebody. And we have to make sure, no two ways about it, that we'll always be before the throne of God in prayer. I told you last week that there are three realms that we enter into when we pray. The first one, Jesus said, when you go to pray, get into your closet or get by yourself. So the first area is a hidden place where you physically go to get away from all the hustle and bustle of the world, get away from all the things that's going on, get away from everything that's happening. The first place you go is that hidden place, a physical hidden place, so that you, whether it's your closet, whether it's your bedroom, whether it's under your bed, in your car, but wherever you got to go, in your basement, wherever you got to go to get there, so you can just turn off the TV, get rid of everything else, and just be in that place where you can begin to find some alone time with God. The second realm, or the second place you go to, once you find that hidden place, is now you begin to pray and you go into the heavenlies. What's the heavenlies? The atmosphere. Now, I'm not talking about heaven. The atmosphere. We'll talk about heaven in a minute, but I'm talking about the atmosphere. What's happening in the atmosphere around us? Well, we know one thing. The Bible tells us that the devil, or Satan, is the prince of the power of the air. So that means that all throughout our atmosphere, there's devils and there's demons. What did Paul say in Ephesians 6? He said, we're fighting not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness of this world, and spiritual wickedness in high places. He's talking about any atmosphere. And so when you begin to pray, the first thing that happens is those in the atmosphere begin to attack you. Those in the heavenlies begin to attack you. And so what did I tell you last week? What you have to do is you have to begin to go on the offensive. And how do I do that? With the word of God, because that's my weapon. The sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. That's my weapon. I use the word of God. I find out what the word of God has to say and say, it is written. And then call out the word of God. Like Jesus said, it is written. Man should not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. He quoted Deuteronomy chapter 8. He says, it is written. That's what we have to do. Quote what the Bible says. Speak God's word. And when we began to speak God's word, let me tell you what begins to happen. What begins to happen is every demon and every devil begins to tremble. Every single one of them begins to shake. They look at you and they say, man, if he just says, speak the word of God, we can deal with him. But he's speaking the word of God. He's saying what God said. Because, listen, every single devil, every demon, Satan himself has to bow their knee to the word of God. It is God's word. God is still in control. The devil, listen, he might be in rebellion, but he cannot resist what God says. Woo! Did you hear what I said? He may be in rebellion, but he cannot resist what God says. See, we have this picture of the devil that he's in rebellion and he's just doing what he wants to do and he run around and just doing it. He can't just run around helter-skelter and do what he wants to do. He can't. He does not have that authority. And so once you get past the heavenlies in your prayers, you begin to pray and you're getting attacked. But with the word of God, you're able to do what? Dispel, resist those devils, and they flee from you. And that takes you then into the third realm, which is the holy place. And it's there where you become absorbed in God's presence. That's the place where you begin to make confession. Your petition, your adoration and praise to God, your intercession, your thanksgiving. That's the place where you begin to just pour out your heart before God without any interference from the enemy, because you've dispelled them and resisted them when you went into the heavenlies before you got to the holy place. Now you say, Pastor, I prayed. I don't remember those steps. No, you don't. You don't necessarily consciously understand those steps. You just get on your knees and begin to pray. But I'm telling you, that's the process you go through. And when you get, because let's just break real here. Have you ever been in that position where you're praying and man, all of a sudden all kind of junk comes up and man, seems like the devil is scraping the bottom of the barrel to throw junk at you and curse words at you and everything else. And it seems like your mind is flooded with all that stuff and it's all designed to keep you from coming into the holy place. Coming into the holy place. What scripture do I have for that? Very simply. Daniel began to pray, and he was praying for 3 weeks for an answer to a vision that he had. He was praying for 3 weeks. The angel finally came to him and said, listen, man, the minute you began to pray, the Lord dispatched me to come to you and bring you the answer. He said, but on my way, the prince of Persia buffeted me. I had to fight. He said, so for 3 weeks, I've been fighting. He said, and finally, another one of the angels came to me and helped me and began to help me in this fight and took over the fight, and then I came to you. So even getting an answer, listen, even getting an answer from God to you goes through the heavenlies, and there's a fight there. You don't even know how many times angels have been fighting on your behalf to get a word from God into your ear. How many times they have been fighting and dealing with the adversary just so they can come to tell you, peace, be still. To tell you, it's going to be all right, don't be worried. To tell you, God has got your back. You're okay. You're going to make it through. See, we sit around and say, oh, man, why didn't God hear me? Why isn't God listening to me? Why? God is listening to you. He hears you. He hears you. But there's a fight that is happening. There's an army that has to be built up. The army of the saints and the army of the angels. And let me tell you, when we work together, the army of the angels and the army of the saints, there's nothing we can't do. Because they're on their mission to make sure they bring word from heaven to you. And you've got to be on your mission to be on your knees with your hands together praying to God. Because through those prayers that you make, as you begin to pray, you strengthen their ability. You strengthen their resolve. You strengthen them to be able to come through. You are battling the same enemy they're battling. So as you begin to speak the word of God, those demons begin to flee. And that angel can come and speak into your ear and say, God's got your back. Don't you worry about it. You're going to make it. The money is coming here tomorrow. Whatever the situation may be, but God has had an answer for you. And there's never a time that God does not answer you. So, Pastor, wait a minute. Why does it sometimes seem I'm not getting an answer from God? Because you give up too quickly. You give up too quickly. I'm going to tell you a secret. Many times God allows us to have a need. So we'll be moved to pray about it. Why is that? Because God wants your time with Him to be special. And every time, or all the time, I should say, that you spend with God is a special time. And so as you come before Him and you kneel before Him, God is giving you His full attention. But Pastor, there's 2 billion Christians in the world. Plus all the kingdoms and all the dimensions and all the realms that God is over and that's under Him. And he's got to deal with all that. And He listens to my lowly little prayer. Yes, He does. Yes, He does. He'll never forsake you. Never forsake you. He'll never give up on you. You might give up on yourself, but God is not giving up on you. You sit around saying, oh, it's useless. It's just no use. And God is saying, oh, it's not useless. Hey, stick with it. Stand up. Be strong. Don't give in. Don't bend. Don't break. Don't bow. You can make it. Come on. You can make it. The Holy Spirit in you is saying, come on, rise up and shout the shout of victory. And all we do is listen to the devil's voice. You can't make it. You ain't nobody. You look at you. You can't. I remember when I was a kid, they used to have a saying. If you're black, get back. Yes, she remembers that. If you're brown, stick around. Oh, wait a minute. That didn't make sense to me. And once I got saved, I was like, man, listen, if I'm black, I'm right with God. Because I'm saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost. God didn't say to me, oh boy, you know, I made you very lowly. You know, He made all of us a little lower than the angels. Not just one section of folk, all of us. That's why racism is so stupid. I'm serious. That's why racism is so stupid. We're sitting around debating stuff that God has said, listen, I made every single one of you in my image. We are made in the image of God. Every single human being is made in the image of God. And so therefore, we deserve to give one another the proper respect. We deserve to give one another the thought of you're the best that God has made. Come on, somebody. And we stand around talking about, oh, I'm nobody's victim. I'll say it again. I'm nobody's victim. I used to be the devil's victim. But Jesus rescued me. I'm not a victim anymore. I don't bow down to those kind of, that kind of craziness and that kind of crazy talk that the devil comes. I don't bow down to that. I don't take that into myself. I don't take that into my mind. I don't take that into my heart. Instead, what I do is I stand with God every step of the way. When he says jump, I'm like, I'm jumping. How high you want me to jump, Lord? Because I'm with you. Listen, it's better to serve in heaven. People think they're going to go to hell and they're going to be big time. Ain't no fun in hell. And you won't be big time in hell. It's better to serve God in heaven, the God who is eternal. You know what eternal means? Eternal means he has no beginning and no end. See, we will be immortal, but God is eternal. He is eternal. Father, Son, Holy Ghost, the eternal God. I want to serve him. Whatever capacity he chooses is okay with me. Whew, praise God. So we're also not only just to pray, but to watch and pray. Mark 13:33 says, take heed, watch and pray, for you know not when the time is. Jesus said, watch and pray. And then in Hebrews 13:17, it says this. I'm about to get in trouble now. Obey your leaders and submit to them, for they keep what? Watch over your souls. Watch means to lay awake. And not just lay awake and count the time, but to lay awake and pray. So they watch over your souls as those who will give an account. One day I have to give an account for you, Evesto. I have to stand before God and say, well, he says, what about Evesto? Well, what am I going to say? I need to be able to say he's a good servant of the living God. He served you well. He was a good soldier in the army. When we took time to pray, he prayed with fervency. He prayed diligently. He called down the weapons of heaven upon the enemy. Or will the report be, well, Lord, he was just sometimey. He showed up when he wanted to. And, you know, we was wondering about him. I'm surprised he even made it. No, he'll give a good, I'll give a good report for you, Lovesto. Obey your leaders, submit to them, for they keep watch over your soul as those who will give an account. Let them do this with what? Joy, and not with grief, for this will be unprofitable for you. Watching cites the enemy. Praying fights the enemy. Spiritual warfare is serious business. It is serious, serious business. The enemy is always looking to harm you and you and your family. Always looking to cause chaos and destruction. And not only your family, but the church everywhere. He's always looking to do that. And listen, he's persistent. He does not stop. He doesn't get tired. He's a different classification of being than we are. We get tired. We need sleep. He doesn't need sleep. He doesn't get tired. Remember, Lucifer is an angel, or was an angel, who we now call Satan. He rebelled against God, but he was still made like the other angels. And they're tireless. They're strong. They're wise. They have wisdom we don't have. And he's using all that to attack you and I. So he's always looking to do harm to you and your family. He wants to destroy your testimony and hinder the work of the Lord. And that's the biggest issue. He wants to stop or hinder the work of God. You really don't matter to him, but you're a means to an end. And what I mean by that is very simply, if he can stop you, if he can crush you, if he can cause you to be balled up in a fetal position in the middle of your floor saying, oh, God doesn't love me anymore, then he's took out a soldier. He's taken out a soldier. Better to be on your knees in prayer, resisting the devil so that he flees, than balled up in a fetal position somewhere in the middle of your floor talking about God doesn't love you anymore. So he's then taking you out of the fight. That means there's less soldiers. Now, we know Jesus wins in the end. We know that Jesus has already won the war. But see, there's battles still to fight. There's battles and battles and battles that we fight, and we fight them every single day. And let me tell you, saint of God, if you're not willing to fight the battle, then you're useless. You are useless as an officer or a soldier in the army of God. But God hasn't given up on you. See, because at one time or other, most of us have been useless in that fight, haven't we? Succumbing to our feelings, our emotions, buying into what the devil told us, what the world tells us. Oh, you got two strikes against you. You're black and you're whatever. You know, all the, I ain't got no strikes against me. God opens the doors that it's impossible for men to open. God is the way maker. He makes the way that no man can make. He does for me what others cannot do. No man, no, I don't care who it is, be the richest man in the world. He can't do for me what God does for me. As I said, we're not victims. We're victorious. We're victorious. We're not victims. And if you see yourself as a victim, you need to change your mind. You need to do what the Bible says. Have your mind washed by the water of the word. Have your mind washed by the water of the word. In other words, the word of God. Get the word of God in you, and it will change how you think. If you're sitting around thinking, oh, I'm limited in what I can do because of this factor or that factor or the other factor. Listen, nothing. What does Jesus say? Jesus said, nothing is impossible for us. Nothing. You got to believe that. You have to stand on that. We cannot give up. We cannot take this battle lightly. It's war. And we're waging this war against the enemy of God and the enemy of man. And that's Satan. We can't give up as most people do. We cannot get discouraged. Many times thinking like we're the only ones and nobody else understands me. God understands you. He made you. He understands you better than you understand yourself. He understands that you're just wallowing in your own grief. You're wallowing in your own stink. You're wallowing rather than standing up saying, I refuse to receive all this mess from the enemy. Instead, I'm standing with God. Listen, you and God, no matter where you are, you and God are always a majority. And so what if you are by yourself? You still have the Holy Spirit of God. Can I share a story with you? The Bible tells us over in the book of Genesis that Abraham had a nephew. His name was Lot. And that nephew, him and the herdsmen of Abraham and Lot were clashing on a regular basis with, where their stock was feeding, and they were all feeding in the same spot. And they were fighting on a regular basis, getting down to where they were punching each other out. And finally, Lot and Abraham went up on a hill and looked over, and Lot said, Abraham says, look, he says, this contention between us, I don't want that. He says, so here's all the land before us. He says, you choose what portion you want. He says, and you take that portion for your livestock, and I'll take the other portion. So Lot looked around. He saw this fertile, beautiful land over here. Man, it was just like the Garden of Eden. It was just lush. He says, I'll take that. But in all that, in the midst of all that, there were some evil cities. There's five of them, actually. But the Bible talks about Sodom and Gomorrah. And so he went to live in this city while his herdsmen were out in these cities, this twin city, Sodom and Gomorrah. He went to live there, and when he got there and realized, once he began to realize what was going on, well, these folks were living all kind of sexually deviant lives, doing all manner of things that was against God, that he knew was against God. And when it came down to it, God finally told Abram, he said, listen, he says, I'm going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. That's why I'm here. And Abraham said, now he knew Lot was there. Now he didn't say, Lord, rescue Lot. He just said, Lord, if there's 50 righteous in this city, will you not destroy it for the sake of 50 righteous? He said, if there's 50 righteous in Sodom and Gomorrah, I will not destroy it. He says, Lord, maybe it's not quite 50, maybe it's only 40. God said, I won't destroy it for 40. He said, how about 30? Not for 30. How about 20? He said, not even for 20. He said, Lord, I don't want to get on your last nerve. I don't want to be a pest. He said, but how about if there's only 10 righteous people? And Abraham had to think, there's got to be 10 righteous folk in this town, these twin cities. He says, if there's only 10. And God said, if there's only 10, I'll spare it. When he sent his angels on ahead and they got there, there wasn't 50 or 40 or 30 or 20. There wasn't even 10. There was only Lot. Only Lot. His two daughters were espoused or engaged to marry two guys, and they tried to get them to come with them when the angel said it's time to go. And they made sport of Lot. The people around town made sport of Lot. They tried to snatch him out and bring him out to them so they get to know him, as the Bible uses that euphemism. And the angel said, look, we've got to go because we got to go. They left, Sodom and Gomorrah was destroyed. So he was the only one. The only one by himself. See, never talk about, oh, Lord, I'm the only one. He was the only one. God said, the outcry has come to me about Sodom and Gomorrah. Who made the outcry? The only one. Lot. Lot was crying out about the wickedness. Lot was crying out. He was crying out. God responded to his outcry. Listen, God will respond to your outcry. We sit around and talk about how evil and bad the world is. That's just the way it is. No, that's not just the way it is. We need to have an outcry. You may say, Lord, listen, look what's going on. This is not right. Lord, redeem the time. Lord, change what's going on. Lord, change this thing. Deal with these people. Deal with these spirits. Deal with this thing, oh God. And as we began to have an outcry, God will then begin to move his hand throughout this world. It's not, listen, it will happen because God is looking for us to do something. We're sitting around looking for God to do something, and God is saying, no, I'm looking for you to do something. How do I know that? Because the Bible tells me very simply this. God says time and time again, if you draw near to me, then I'll draw near to you. That's a mathematical statement. If then statement, you learned that in algebra. If this, then that. God said, if you draw near, then I'll draw near. If you pray, then I'll move. If you call out, then I'll answer. Come on, somebody. We're looking for God to do something. He said, no, 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 no. I've given you the power. I've given you authority. I've given you my spirit. You do something. You call out. You declare a thing. You say, Lord, we're not going to have this anymore. We're not going to have all kind of foolishness and evil in our government. We're not going to have evil around us anymore. We're not going to have evil in our classrooms. We're not going to have evil anywhere around us. We are going to stand and stand therefore. We're going to fight this battle. We're going to wage war in the heavenlies with our prayers. We're going to counterattack the enemy with the word of God. We're going to stand and stand and stand and stand and stand and stand and stand, and we won't get tired. We'll continue to stand. Elijah said, Lord, I'm the only one. After the fire came down and lapped up the bullocks and the offering and the water and even the stones, everything was burnt up. They slayed or killed all the prophets of Baal. Over 400 prophets of Baal. Killed them all. And then Jezebel says, he killed my prophets. She said, by this time tomorrow, I'm going to kill him. Elijah ran. He got out there. He was by himself with God. He said, Lord, I'm the only one left. I'm the only one, only faithful one left. Nobody else will serve you in all of Israel but me. And the Lord said, no, man, you got it wrong. You think you're by yourself. He said, I've got 7,000. This is over 1 Kings 19:18. He said, I've got 7,000 in Israel that have not bowed their knees to Baal or put their mouths on him to kiss him. I've got 7,000. He said, let me tell you something. You're not by yourself. He said, now you get yourself up. Get yourself together. He says, and you go and speak to this one and tell Elisha that he's going to be the next prophet after you. And you do this, and he gave him instruction. He didn't sit there and allow him to wallow like that. He said, listen, you're not by yourself. Now you get up and let's take care of some business. Because we've got kingdom business to take care of. And the same is true today. We have kingdom business to take care of. We need to get ourselves up, quit wallowing, and say, Lord, I am your servant. Like Isaiah said, when God says, who shall I send? And Isaiah said, send me. Send me. We've got to be willing to be sent. We've got to raise our hands and say, send me, Lord. I got a brother in this church. He said the Lord told him he's the watchman on the wall. And you know something? Since the Lord told him that, he has been the watchman on the wall around this church. And I thank God for him because, see, he stood up and said, I'm the watchman, Pastor. I'm the watchman on this wall. I'm not going to let anything go down here because it is my job. My job. To be the watchman on the wall. So it ain't nothing like knowing who you are, your calling, what God has deemed you to be. Glory to God. Satan doesn't give up, so why should you give up? As I told you before, he's tireless, he's persistent, he's very resourceful. And one last thing, he's desperate. Lastly, I know I'm a little past my time, but I just want to share this with you. And that is what Paul says here at the very end. He says, pray on my behalf. And I think I said this last week. We've got to pray for one another. He said, that utterance be given to me in the opening of my mouth. In other words, he says, pray for me that I continue to speak the word of God. I continue to declare Jesus to everybody I see and everybody I know. Now, mind you, he was in chains at this time. And he goes on to say, to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador. He's in chains, but he declares himself an ambassador for the gospel. Just as you and I and each one of us are ambassadors for the gospel. We are ambassadors, and as we pray for one another, we are strengthened by the prayers of the saints. You know, there was a pastor, I cannot recall his name at this point in time anymore, but there was a pastor who, under the stage of his church where he preached, and they had a basement underneath there, and under there would be four or five ladies, and the whole time he's preaching, they were praying. Sometimes they pray so loud that you could hear them in the sanctuary as he's preaching. And one time he told the people, he said, listen, he said, don't worry about that. He said, because that's the sisters in the church who are underneath this podium and underneath this, down in the basement, rather. He says, those are the sisters praying for me, praying that the Spirit of God would stay upon me, praying that the Spirit of God would speak through me, praying that the Spirit of God would proclaim his power through me, praying as I'm preaching so that the Word of God can go forth with much power and much success. Saints, listen, if you're not praying for me as your pastor, something's wrong. And if I'm not praying for you, something's wrong. We have to pray for one another. We are ambassadors. We may not be in chains like Paul was, but we are still ambassadors. We are ambassadors for Christ through the kingdom of God to this nasty world we live in. Let me get back to my place. The prayers of the saints can strengthen the spirit of the brethren and battle the enemy forces that are coming against them. There may be some brother in some jungle somewhere. There may be some brother in Nigeria who's surrounded by Muslims. And you don't even know anything about him. You know nothing except you're just saying, Lord, there are men and women around this world who are facing problems right now, who are in strife and going through because of what they believe. Father, I pray for them in the name of Jesus that you strengthen them, encourage them, dear Heavenly Father. Lift them up, oh God. And as you begin to pray for them, that brother over there surrounded, he gains strength. He gains boldness. He stands and begins to proclaim and shout the gospel of the kingdom. And you know what begins to happen? What begins to happen is somebody out there is listening. Listen, I did a funeral not too long ago, and I preached about death, and death was coming for everybody. It wasn't a very nice thing for me to say. I know it, but I know what God was telling me to say, and I had to say what God was telling me to say. And I thought to myself after I was done, I said, oh Lord, did I blow this thing? This is terrible. I messed up. But then all of a sudden somebody came up to me and said, God bless you, brother. You preached salvation. You told us the truth. Thank you so much. Then somebody else came up to me and said, thank you, brother. You told us the truth. And at the committal, as I was walking away, my wife and I was walking away, there was a man standing there with tears in his eyes. And he said, brother, he said, I didn't know. He said, I just didn't know. He said, I didn't know the things you were talking about. I didn't know. He says, thank you so much. And you can see the tear, big man's tears streaming down his face. Thank you so much. He said, I just didn't know. This is a spiritual battle. This is spiritual warfare. We got to fight in the spirit. We got to stand strong, don't we? And he's preaching back to me what I was saying. I was like, yes, brother, that's it exactly. You got it. He says, thank you so much. So God brought forth the word he wanted to touch the people he wanted. You may not touch everybody, but that's all right. You will touch the ones that God wants you to touch, because his word will go forth and it will not come back void. But it will accomplish the very thing that God has set out for it to accomplish. And you never know the people that you may touch. You never know the folks on the peripheral of when you're talking, and there might be a little crowd around you and some guy way in the back, but he's listening, he's hearing, his heart is being pricked, he's being convicted, and in his heart he's calling out on the name of Jesus. Oh Lord, I didn't know it was like this. I didn't know what it was about. I had no idea. I had no clue. Save me, Jesus. You may walk away not seeing a hand raised. You may walk away from there not knowing anybody was touched, but God has a way. If you remain a good soldier of the cross. Last thing, you might be fighting the fight of your life against the enemy, but you're still the ambassador for Jesus Christ. Which means what? You speak boldly. And you can pray for boldness. You know that? You can pray for boldness. You can ask God to give you boldness. He'll give it to you. Yeah, he'll give it to you liberally. The prayers of the saints enables us to fight the good fight. And it's a fight we will not lose. We haven't lost, because Jesus, glory to God, Jesus, our Lord and Savior, Jesus, our conqueror, Jesus, our King, Jesus, the King of the kingdom, hallelujah, Jesus is with me wherever I go. I'm filled with the Holy Ghost of God, glory. I can speak boldly, not holding my tongue back, but I'll let the Spirit of the Lord loose. We know that prayer works. We know it works. We've seen people healed and delivered. We've seen people brought forth from the brink. I can personally recount to you the many different healings we have had in our ministry. A woman who was deaf. We were down in Texas, my wife and I. She was deaf, and somebody came over and said, Pastor, would you pray for her? I told her, take your things out of your ears. And I put my fingers in her ear just like Jesus did. See, I'm going to emulate my Savior, Jesus. I put my fingers in her ear, and I cast that deaf spirit out. We went to lunch right after that. She came over to our table, and she showed me her hearing aid with the things all wrapped up. She said, I don't need these anymore. I've been healed. I got a miracle. We used to connect with the church in Grand Rapids, and we had a Friday fire. Friday once a month, we would gather together, their congregation, our congregation, anybody else who wanted to come, and we'd have a service. And I can tell you, on three separate occasions at Friday fire, three separate occasions, a woman got three different women, three different times, got up out of wheelchairs, walked those wheelchairs out. Got up out of wheelchairs. A baby that the pastor of the other church called and said, would y'all come and pray for this baby? My wife and I grabbed that baby, because the baby was, I can't tell you what it was. It was messed up in the brain, eyes. It had some other disease in the body, and we prayed for that baby, and that baby was miraculously delivered in the name of Jesus. And that's just a small amount of the different miracles and healings we have seen here. Sister Cinda, when I was preaching, it wasn't even a year ago. Was it about a year ago? And she had an operation on her feet. And I began to talk about the power of God, how God moves. And this woman, she had a boot on and all this other stuff, and her feet was, she had a little trike thing she had to run. And she started unlacing that boot. I didn't even see her at first. She's sitting right where she's sitting now. She started unlacing that boot. And I'm preaching and I'm shouting and everybody's shouting, and she's just steady unlacing. Then she stood up, because everybody else said she stood up. She kicked the boot off. And then she stood up and she began to walk. And that's when I noticed. I said, Sister, all I could do was look at God. Look at God. We've seen it here time and time again. We've seen it in Grand Rapids time and time again. Miracles and healings. It's the power of Almighty God. How can we submit to the devil when God gives us such power? When God anoints us that way, how can we then turn around and say, God's not with me, I'm by myself? Prayer works. When we stand on the word of God, he heals, he delivers, he brings you through, he gives you victory. You become greater and mightier than any other human being because the power of God is in you. We're going to start having some prayer days at the church so that we can then begin to harness our power and put it to use. Begin to cry out about some things and put the anointing of God to use so the kingdom first becomes a place where the anointing of God flows in like a mighty river. Glory to God. Have you been blessed this morning? We're going to continue this about waging war. There's a few more things I want to tell you. I'm done with prayer portion, but I got another step I'm going to take you to, because it's necessary that we really know our enemy, because you cannot fight a war without knowing your enemy, knowing how he does what he does and why he does what he does. And the help that we have. We've already talked about a lot, but there's even some deeper things. Amen? Well, if you've been blessed this morning, just give a shout out to the Lord. For those watching by streaming live, God bless you. Thanks for being with us today. It has been a joy and a privilege to have you part of our service, and we pray that this has been a blessing to you and help you in your Christian life to be an overcomer, not a victim, but to be an overcomer in Jesus' name. Glory to God. We'll see you next time.
We are grateful you chose to join us today for Pastor Dave's teaching. If you have questions during the week or are in need of prayer, please email us at office@kingdomfirstfw.com and be sure to join us for our next broadcast. During this time, please remember to be safe, be well, and be blessed.